Good evening, I'm Melisa Idris.
And I'm Sharaad Kutin.
Welcome to Consider This, the show where we want you to consider and then reconsider the news of the day. Now, of course, the biggest news has been the inquest on fireman Muhammad Adib Muhammad Qasim's death. So after a 41-day inquest, the coroner's court has now ruled that Adib's death was the result of a criminal act, saying that blunt force trauma was to his chest was not caused by an accident. So what does this tell us after so long, so many days of an inquest?
Well, Melissa, there's also the additional point, which I think sometimes gets lost in the media report, which is that the SOPs around the police managing a riot situation also called into question. The police were asked whether they, you know, got there in time and so on and so forth. The IGP has in fact responded by saying he thinks that the SOPs might not themselves be a problem, but he's going to look at whether the police follow those SOPs.
Yeah, I think after so many days, no, you have to remember that the incident happened 10 months ago, and then we had this 41-day inquest. Now, even after so many days, there are still so many questions that remain. I mean, who is going to be held accountable for this? Who is going to be charged for this murder? What we do know is the fact that the coroner's court has ruled that it was perhaps two or more persons that were involved in Adib's death,
right,
but who will be held accountable?
Right, so the inquest could not identify the assailants, but so it's left up to the police, I guess, at this point in time to pursue that investigation. We also note, I think, that, you know, around Adib has been quite a bit of political mobilization, and I think for observers, the question is whether there's going to be kind of political, you know, action around this, whether in fact some people are going to be trying to make political capital from the inquest, whether, you know, the result has been in their favor or not, as some people put it. The larger issue of the temple and its relocation and the emotive politics around that also remains, I think, for Malaysia, one of those issues that needs really careful attention.
Yeah, and I have to say, you know, if you remember when this happened, right, it brought our country to the brink of racial unrest. It was such a tense time. Now, I have to say, after all this, with the, you know, the ruling of the coroner's court, what have we learned from this lesson? Because the ruling is such, but it still leaves all these questions unanswered, and we still want to, you know, find out what happened. But at the end of the day, with the kind of this situation, what have we learned from this incident?
Well, Melissa, I think that, you know, we'll come away learning that Malaysia, to a large extent, respect processes, and there was a due process, and I think that was carried out to the best of the abilities of the authorities concerned. But because there are some people in the country who are intent on mobilizing around issues of race and identity, that these moments become flashpoints,
right,
rather than just looking at this tragedy as a tragedy of an individual who was hurt in a riot. It has become a question of mobilizing identity politics. So have we moved on from identity politics? Perhaps not. The rest of the world hasn't.
Definitely.
Will we be able to ourselves?
Exactly. And speaking about the rest of the world, as we wrap up the week, let's do a quick follow-up of some of the biggest stories of the week. Now, in the US, of course, the biggest story there has to be the beginning of the impeachment inquiry by Nancy Pelosi, the speaker in the U.S. House of Representatives. And then now we have a U.S. media report saying that the whistleblower whose complaint has led to that impeachment inquiry against Donald Trump is in fact a CIA officer. This according to the New York Times, the Washington Post, as well as Reuters. So all of these news agencies confirming that the whistleblower did in fact work in the White House.
Yeah, so I think what interests to perhaps audiences, as it were, to the American drama, the American political drama, is Donald Trump has come close to being impeached and on many other occasions, questions into the way in which he relates to foreign powers and the American system that that criminalizes such relationships. So we see another instance of it. This time it seems like Donald Trump might in fact be sent, as it were, into the dock to answer questions. Now, that impeachment process might or might not lead to his conviction. In the case of Bill Clinton all those years ago, Melissa, remember, he was involved in an impeachment process. He was not found guilty and so did not resign.
Well, okay, so with the US, I'm not sure what's going to happen next, whether this inquiry will move forward, likely in the House of Representatives, where the Democrats hold a majority, whether it will get blocked in the Senate, where the Republicans hold a majority. But at the end of the day, what we will be watching closely as media commentators will be the sentiment of this, because as we head into the 2020 elections in the US, what will this mean for Republican candidates, for Donald Trump as a Republican candidate, I guess, you know, looking for re-election? Could he stumble at the ballot box and make it, you know, given the sentiment of the U.S. citizens there?
Yeah, you know, Melissa, of course, you know, I think I've said this many times, I have no skin in the game for in terms of American politics. But to the extent that the leader of the largest power in the Western Hemisphere, and the fact that Donald Trump has been so disruptive to many ways in which international relations are governed, his fate and the fate of his successors, I think, are very interesting for us to watch.
Well, closer to home, Indonesia was also in focus this week. Now, for days, Indonesia has been rocked by student protests against a new corruption law and plans to revamp the draconian criminal code. Now, the latest news is that an Indonesian student has died from a chest wound, and this as riots erupted in Kendari City on Sulawesi. So yeah, this is the first fatality.
Yeah, the first, and there's also another student in critical condition. Students reminding the Indonesian government of its promise to uphold democracy, a promise they made 20 years ago, and for largely they have delivered on. The framing of the story, very interesting, and some Malaysian media has framed very narrowly around the question of premarital sex, the law to criminalize premarital sex. Of course, that is a huge affront to fundamental liberties in the individual, in any democracy.
But it's so much more than that, isn't it?
It is so much more than that. In the fact that the Anti-Corruption Agency of Indonesia was going to be weakened after stunning successes these last two decades, also perhaps, you know, a very serious charge against President Jokowi, only newly re-elected. He's come out, in fact, to defend his commitment to democracy. But as they say, the proof is in the pudding, in the eating. So if Jokowi does not deliver and he panders to, you know, partisan groups within the assembly, the DPR, we'll see how this all pans out.
Okay, so one thing to remember, though, while the most, I guess, headline grabbing issue is the proposed ban on extramarital sex, but remember, the protests go far beyond that, and we will be keeping a very close eye on what's happening there in Indonesia. Now, coming up in just a couple of minutes, we're going to be speaking to the organizers of the global climate strike here in KL. So make sure you stay tuned to consider this. Welcome back to Consider This. I'm Melissa Idris. With me, Sharaad Kutin. Now, last weekend, various major cities around the world held a global climate strike to protest climate change. Now, Malaysia was not left out. We had one here, a protest here in KL. Now, at the forefront of the Malaysian chapter is Klima Action Malaysia, or better known as KAMI. And today on the show, we have the co-founders of KAMI. We have Ili Nadia Zulfakar, as well as Nurul Fitra American. Welcome to the show, guys. So tell us a little bit in terms of, now that it's been slightly more than a week that it has happened, what's the purpose of having that? You know, you wanted to be part of the global campaign to protest climate change. What was the response like here in Malaysia for that strike?
Okay, first of all, this strike is not our first strike. We've already planned and organized three other strikes prior to this. And this particular global climate strike, we call it as a My Climate Strike, is the culmination of all these previous strikes, all these actions, the workshops we've been doing, the documentary screening, and you know, solidarity actions with communities, and that is the culmination of those activities. And this is like basically the grand finale of all what of this campaign that we call as Ops Darurat Iklim.
Okay.
Yeah.
All
so right. The response was massive. We were slightly taken back with you know, there's a lot of you know, how do I say, engagement from other communities as well. For example, we have Zero Waste Malaysia coming in and saying, hey, we would like to join you.
That's an NGO.
Yes, it's an NGO. We have NGOs coming in, communities coming in, the communities that we have engaged before, for example, the Orang Asli community in Gua Musang have came down, you know, from their villages.
So the haze didn't impact people's turnout of this strike, right?
Absolutely not.
Because it was like
not.
The peak of the haze where everyone was with the masks.
I think it roused people more, yeah.
Yes. Oh, okay. Because, that gave some people...
Okay, I want to ask you. Yeah, Fitra, you know, help me understand some of the kind of assertions that were made at the gathering. There were banners that read, there is no planet B, or plantations are not real forests, you know, system change, not climate change. Let's start with that. System change, not climate change. It's a big assertion. What is it that you think it means?
To me, like what we are trying to, we are not trying to change the world. We are trying to see the local context of what is happening in Malaysia. Like, for example, we, like, usually when we heard the story of climate change, it would be the story of like carbon emission, that sort of thing. But when you, like, there is that banner saying that ladang hutan bukan hutan, that sort of thing, which is like we want to bring the local context to the story of climate change in Malaysia, because like we don't really have that story of global south made known to the public. Right. Yeah.
Okay, so now that you've had the strike and you've had these conversations, in you know, the idea of kind of localizing the protest to give it a Malaysian flavor, Malaysian context, what were some of the conversations that came out of this? So you had, you know, all the other NGOs now part of this. What were the conversations that you've seen happen throughout the week following this, or has it kind of just dissipated following the end of the strike?
Oh. And end of the haze.
Yeah.
Well,
the
maybe
haze.
Not today. The haze seems to have come back today, but okay.
Yes. No, actually the conversation has been continuous, and we are really glad because of that. We are still getting messages and, you know, engagement from other communities asking, when's the next climate strike? What is your next action? And things like that. I think it's really important to, you know, highlight this, that we are not the, we are basically not the only groups that is pushing for the climate agenda in Malaysia. There are other groups as well. They are, we have the SETDAM, we have the Malaysian Youth Delegation doing things as well at the policy level, but we are moving at the grassroots level. We are talking with the communities. We want to empower the communities to push to overturn this lack of political, I would say, will in Malaysia in addressing issue of climate crisis.
So this seems to me that it's very youth-led, right? Youth-centric. Has that been the case? Did you see, you know, the composition of the people who turned up for the strike, the people who are engaged and talking about it, and perhaps pushing for more action? Has this predominantly been youth-centric? Fitra, what do you think?
I think it has been like very youth-centric, but also like to highlight that it is very privileged community.
Like, so you very can urban.
Urban, yeah, urban. Okay. Sorry, it's either you are urban community or you are the community that are directly affected by this climate crisis. Like, for example, the fishermen, and then the Orang Asli, and also we have like people like the farmers. But then you don't really see like the below middle class people getting into in touch with this climate stories yet.
Why do you think that is?
I think it's partly because the way our climate is being climate science is being communicated in Malaysia. First of all, climate is issues of climate crisis has always been the domain of the English, you know, language.
Okay.
And we don't have a lot of materials in Bahasa Malaysia. I think that is one of our, I would say, strategy so far to disseminate all this information in Bahasa Melayu, and also to use tools like art. To engage people through art, when we talk about something so broad like climate crisis.
You used the word darurat, which is a word that, at least in the Malaysian context, we only refer to in terms of 1948 and that darurat, right? So the emergency, which was a political nature. Now, you're saying that you had wanted, one of the demands you made, and you were quoted, Nadia, in The Diplomat, saying that you want the government to declare this a crime, an emergency. Have you gotten a response from the government? Are they willing to do that? And what would be their response if they did, in fact, declare such an emergency? Mm-hmm.
So far, we have not managed to get any response from the government, which is really quite depressing and destitute as well. But we are determined to go through with this. We are planning for our second phase of action, which is to plan for a citizens' assembly, whereby it's a platform whereby you have other stakeholders in the public and also companies that can come in and sit down and discuss about the climate crisis and come up with solutions that we can present to the government. I think the government has a, there has been a lot of action. I'm not saying that the government is not doing anything. Mm. They've been talking a lot about a lot of issues like, the plastic pollution. Like yesterday, they just made an announcement about the liberalisation of the electricity in Malaysia. I think they've been doing a lot of good job, but that being said, the climate issue is a really, really broad issue.
So with Kami, the NGO that you both founded, what is it that you want, kind of concrete requests to the government? What is it that you're asking for specifically?
I think the thing that we want the government to do is to give to listen to the scientists, all these environmental lobbyists that has been doing groundwork for longer than us. Mm-hmm. I think they have been there for a lot of time, for longer than us, and they have been, lack of engagement by the government to this side. And there's been a strong lobbyist coming from these corporations that run at tribes in this capitalist economy. I think this is something that we want the government to understand that.
Well, you don't want it to be business as usual.
Yes, right. Exactly. Yes.
Some kind of change. All right, so we're going to come back and continue this conversation with the good folks from Kami right here on Consider This. Stay tuned. Welcome back to Consider This. I'm Melissa Idris. With me, Sharaad Kutan. And joining us on the show, we have Fitra, Nurul Fitra, as well as Ili Nadia. So they're both the co-founders of Klima Action Malaysia, or better known as KAMI. Now, I want to talk to you guys about what the media can do. Because, coming from media practitioners, journalists like ourselves, I'm looking at the reporting of, climate change, climate activism, and, as you mentioned, the need to have this urgency when it comes to reporting on these issues. Are there gaps in the way you see reporting of environmental issues within the local media? What about you, Fitra? What do you think?
As we said before, like a lot of materials that we have currently, it is like in English. You do not see a lot of media reporting in Bahasa Malaysia. Mm-hmm. So I think like if we could shorten the gap, like merge the gap, then it probably could help like people in the kampung or like the rural area to understand what is climate crisis. And I think like it is very important to know that like people like the fishermen or also the farmers, they are already encountering all this aspect of climate crisis, just that they do not know the term climate crisis, that they have been into the sea and into the forest, and they have been seeing like a lot of changes happening like from before this until now. Mm. Getting them to familiar with this terminology would actually help them to understand the issues better, and they could tell the stories from their perspective, and the media could actually get the stories of these people on the ground that has been working like close with the environment to actually understand.
I have to say though, I mean, I'm hearing you talk and you're referring to it as a climate crisis, which is wonderful because you're using the right terminology. Semantics are important. I see, you know, many media news reporters like myself, for instance, we're still using climate change.
Or global warming.
Yes, or global warming, correct. You know, without giving the real sense of the urgency of this crisis. So maybe we should all start referring to it as climate crisis because then it gives it a real sense of urgency.
Okay, Nadia, we've had this particular moment, right? The haze kind of brought back to a lot of Malaysians that we are connected to the land. Mm-hmm. And in this case, in fact, land's not necessarily part of Malaysia. Mm-hmm. The Sumatra and what happens in Sumatra has a detrimental or immediate effect on us. But do you think, now that the haze is clearing, blue skies have come back, that people will forget again, and until and unless something dramatic happens, mm-hmm. Malaysians are going to kind of ignore the story of the climate crisis just because it's not in their face? I mean, what's your sense of how people respond to the mm-hmm. stories that you think are important?
Mm-hmm. I think people have been really optimistic by the idea of youth coming out and standing up for the environment. I don't think this will go down easily as you know, as previously. I think this generation is making a lot of noise about this issue. I'm very optimistic. I think the people will not forget about it. Besides, the sky in Malaysia is getting bluer, but what about in Riau, what about in Sumatra, is getting redder and redder. I think the emergence of stories from the social media, you know, plays a really important role as well. People can see that, hey, this is not only about Malaysia, this is about the world, this is about Southeast Asia. People will stand up, right. I'm sure.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, you know, you mentioned young people, the voices are getting louder. I mean, really the poster child, if I may, of climate, the climate crisis has been Greta Thunberg. But there's been so much backlash coming up from her address at the UN. What did you guys make of that? I mean, what were some of the, I guess, what did you make of the conversations coming out of her address?
Mm-hmm. I think among the things that people ask would be, you just know how to shout and asking people to do something, but you don't have any solution mm-hmm. to it. I think that is a very dangerous mentality when you can only say something or like put pressure on something only if you have the solution. It is totally wrong because that it shouldn't work that way. Mm-hmm. And like as youth, I think like our role is to be check and balance to the government. Yeah, we mm-hmm. should be able to say what we think is right and what is wrong, and the government should listen to us. And not, it is not the job of the civil society to provide solution. We are paying our politicians and they should provide the solution. If not, then you should just pay me.
Yeah. Well, they're working for us.
You pay you a fat salary. I do want to say, in the remaining minutes that we have, I mean, some of the simple solutions that experts have put out are like growing more trees. The fact of preserving the forest that we have, and you, I think in your slogans also, plantations are not real forests. Remember that was that slogan, we green the world. I mean, these are plantation companies saying they're greening the world. Mm. We know that plantations are not forests and they don't do the same things for the planet. But there are some simple solutions, aren't there, Nadia? Simple solutions to help regenerate the earth. Mm-hmm. I mean, what's your sense of the practical things that we could do?
I think the practical things that we can do is, for example, first of all, we need to know what are the effects of our lifestyle, you know, where our food is coming from. There has been like this lack of reporting, lack of information coming from the Malaysian side about, you know, how our forests are being degraded every day, you know, for to produce food for us, you know, simply because of that. Yeah, I think one of the major, you know, information that we have to put forward is to connect Malaysians back to where, you know, where food comes from, you know, where this production goes through and things like that. Yes.
All right, so get educated and get informed, right?
Yes.
Equip yourself with that knowledge. Okay, that's all the time we have on the show today. Thank you so much for being on Consider This. It's been a pleasure speaking with you both. I'm Melissa Idris with Ms. Sharaad Kutan. We will both be back with you same time on Monday. We'll catch you then. Have a great evening. Thank you, guys.